Hi, thank you all for coming here tonight. My name is Jill D'Alessandro, and I am the costume and textile arts curator here at the Fine Arts Museums. And it is my great honor to present this program today. Just a few things. Out of respect, photography is allowed, but no flash photography. We will be taking questions from the audience, and you can submit your questions either via Twitter or email, or on any of the cards that were handed out to you when you arrived. And the questions will happen at the end of the program. If you are not planning to tweet or email, please turn your cell phone off. So again, it is my great honor to have this program, a conversation between Suzy Menkes and Jean-Paul Gaultier. I feel very fortunate at the Fine Arts Museums because, in fact, Suzy Menkes' son lives in the Bay Area, and she comes frequently to visit her family. And so it's always my sort of favorite time of any program, any exhibition, is when Suzy comes and I get to walk through the exhibition with her. And it's so learnful, and I just really wanted to kind of share that opportunity with the rest of the Bay Area. One of my favorite, during the Yves Saint Laurent exhibition, one of my favorite moments was Suzy stopped in her tracks, and she said, she goes, "This is it. This is what is true of any great artist or any great designer. When they do something, it can be shocking and avant-garde, but then years later, we stand and look at it and believe that it has always existed." And I think that is true of Jean-Paul Gaultier's work. And so I know that they have been friends for a very long time. And so it is my honor to introduce both Suzy Menkes, fashion editor of the International Herald Tribune, and Mr. Jean-Paul Gaultier.
I love the love seat. I just want to know, can you hear me? Please shout loudly if you can't. Yes or no? You can hear?
No. Somebody say no.
Mic people, can I be heard? Shall I start? Okay, good. So before I introduce one of the funniest, wittiest, most amusing and funkiest designers that I know, I'd just like to start with something a little bit more serious. You know, in fashion, the reason that people last seems so obvious, perhaps, when you see this exhibition of all its incredible glory and excitement. But at the same time, there are real reasons why designers last. And one of them, when it comes to Jean-Paul Gaultier, is probably what is talked about least. It's the technique, the skill, the handwork, the knowledge. And sometimes it gets buried underneath the fantasies of the clothes. But if you look hard, particularly those of you who are going to go into the exhibition afterwards, if you look on one side to see the incredible punk can-can clothes, wild, exciting, colorful, and then if you look at the central aisle that moves round like a fashion show, which is the Parisian part, you will see the extraordinary craftsmanship that can turn a dress into half a jacket and half a skirt, or can make a trench coat, one of Jean-Paul Gaultier's iconic pieces, into something that's a trench coat, but it's also a pair of shorts. These kind of things, they're not tricks. They are works of extraordinary skill. And if you search in the exhibition, you will find the heart of all that. You will see the very early years that Jean-Paul spent when he was learning Paris couture with Pierre Cardin. And you'll glimpse this young man looking very serious as he fits something to the back of a model. And you will realize that it isn't just by some sort of miracle that these clothes have appeared over the years. There is a really solid basis. The other thing that I want to say is that, you know, there aren't many designers around who've changed the course of history, because when it comes to fashion, yes, there's lots of things that we see. There are lots of excitements, lots of fra-la-la going on. But we don't often see things that you realise have captured a moment in time. And that is what I think you will find in this exhibition. But I don't want to talk anymore because I'm actually someone who believes that you've come to listen to Jean-Paul Gaultier and not to Suzy Menkes.
To mistake.
So, Jean-Paul, I really wanted to ask you, thinking that we are going through the exhibition from the beginning, the power that you gave women with the sexuality, with the corsets, that actually was very much a reflection of what was going on when you did it. Can you tell us about those Madonna corset years?
I should say that, yes, it's kind of reflection of what was happening and also a reflection of my childhood, which is something to see with what was happening around. It means that I have been educated with women. So women were very counting for me, my grandmother and my mother, and they give me and they show me through themselves an example of how women were, you know. It means like, in reality, women that were strong, clever, human, and at the same time, sometimes stronger than men, you know. So that I realized very, very quickly that women could be more interesting, more clever, because maybe of the education, maybe because of the fact of they have not to play football to be quiet, you know, and they were more like into things like to obtain something, they have to be 10 times more clever than the men that have everything for themselves already at the base when they are unborn.
But all we women know we're 10 times more intelligent than men. We know that already.
Yeah, but people doesn't say it and doesn't... Well, I mean like... and men doesn't realize it most of the time. Even if they need, you know. But so that, you know, truly it's... give me that I felt the power of the woman. And at the time, you know, when I was adolescent, there were also like the women's sleeve and that kind of thing. Women which were reacting on taking out their bra and put it in the fire. You know, fire their bra. So it was like a symbol of showing we are as much as the men. And maybe we first try to look like men to see that we are the equal. After became another step. One that was after that, it was the one that women can be as much macho, let's say strong or whatever, than a man, but with also the attribute and, of imagery, of seduction, which was exactly what was into it, Madonna.
So so that we can all understand here. So when you saw Madonna in her pointed corset, this wasn't the first time you'd seen women's underwear.
Definitely.
You had seen it right from the beginning with your grandmother and the work that she did.
Yeah.
And also, isn't there a teddy bear somewhere in this story?
This teddy bear was there, definitely. He was there with a pointed cotton bra. Why? It's because, you know, my parents didn't want, you know, like, because that part of education for a little boy, no, you cannot have a doll and you cannot dress a doll, is not. You have to have a train. So I didn't get the train. They didn't offer me, I must say. So I was not traumatized by the train and even some little cars. So it's why maybe I don't drive. But they offer me like a teddy bear. And that teddy bear, like I couldn't get put in dress my teddy bear. I put him some conic bras that I did with paper, you know, like newspaper or something of a magazine, you know, and with like pins, I put it, I make that bra, which for me was a little maybe like the silhouettes that I saw maybe at the TV, because I was looking a lot at TV, they let me see everything on a lot of movies, you know. And so I tried to reconstitute the body of a woman. And I was making live that little teddy bear, you know, as what...
How old were you at this point?
I think I was around, like, let's say, the teddy bear, I got it at 3 o'clock, but I let him free at that time, at 3 years old. I let him free. And after, I think I was around five that I started to take care about him. First, it was a hair. very important. So I put him air, but with cord, you know, with a cord that I was putting. And I was putting to him exactly what I was seeing on my grandmother, which means that she had like white hair. So I was putting on that little beer, you know, a little rouge color, which was bluish. And I put it, first color was the bluish type. After that, I don't know why, but I say he has to change. So it was more reddish, which for me was a strong color too. And after, I tried to make it black, but that it didn't work because the texture of the painting that it was painting that I was putting on him didn't go with it. So I have to destroy and to start again, first platinum, the color of the straw, and after bluish, and after reddish, and start again. And all the makeup was the makeup of my grandmother. So you can see in the exhibition the teddy bear. I should say that he's a little nice monster, but it's a little monster anyway. And the, well, it doesn't, after it's maybe why, you know, I have some affinity with air. You know, I love the air. I love to touch the air. I like also, maybe I could have been a hairdresser. I think I love that.
I hope you like my hair because all the drag queens last night were trying to copy it.
For the moment, I am not yet a drag queen, but I'm starting, you know, it's going up. Now, look at the photo of me, very shaved. Now, it's a little going up. So thank you for the inspiration.
So for all that we're joking about the corsets, as you say, they had a message. It was not showing women in their underclothes for sexual reasons. It was to show that they were strong women, and certainly Madonna absolutely personified that.
Definitely.
But what is interesting, and we see this in the exhibition, was that actually Madonna in 1990, I think it was, the Blonde Ambition Tour,
yeah,
yes?
Yeah.
But this wasn't the first time you'd done these conical bras. There's a link with Africa. Did I get that right?
I didn't get the thing about Africa.
Well, I thought that when we see Tamel wearing the...
That one, 85. Early, 85. But the first corset dress I did, it was in a collection that was... At that time, you know, the collection were big. So there was like three inspirations, like Querelle de Brest, Dadaism, which was mixed of décolleté, you know, and the lingerie. So one part was the lingerie, and it was in 80. I did it in, I think, in 81, and it came out for the collection in 82. So it was like the corset. I must say, I have been inspired by, of course, my grandmother, but something else. You know, musical. I saw a musical in New York. I saw, it was 9½, I think, something like about the life of Fellini, that they make a movie only like a few years ago, which was not so good. But the play... The play was excellent, you know, it was in Broadway, and there was one scene where all the women were like, preparing themselves for the show. And they were all in corset, like satin and salmon color. And I was like fascinated by it. I think I enjoyed the show, but I was only thinking about that, I must say. And after it was like an obsession, came back the corset of my grandmother, like I have to do it, but in a dress. It will be a dress. So I did like 10 different dresses that were long, different, some shorter, and even like an overall, you know, which was always with a conic bra. And I did it like my souvenir of the one of my grandmother, and with the lace-up. Even I can tell you a little anecdote, which is quite funny, is somebody wore it for one party at the Palace, you know, which was a club, a big club at the epoch, Marie-Christiane Marek. And she wanted to wear that, but she couldn't drink because I did it truly like a real corset. It means only lace up all the back long, you know. She has a jumpsuit, the overall like that. So no drink because after to go to the toilet, what can she do? She cannot put it back. She has to have somebody with her, you know. So it should be in a little too naughty.
The title of this exhibition is the idea of going from the street to fashion, from looking at things that are in the street and turning them into fashion. Or is it the other way around? Do you in fact look at the street and you see immediately things that are already fashion? Are you inspired by that?
I should say that I have... to be honest, I didn't see very clearly by what I was inspired, but it's sure. I don't know if there is like a first time. It can be, I think, everything. But I know that I was touched by things that I find beautiful and that were things that coming definitely from the street. Even like maybe let's say like why I have also like a kind of, not obsession, but I love to work with denim, you know, because also it was not so well seen at that time because I am born in 52. So it's mean like in 58, there were some boys that have like a denim trouser. And me, I couldn't because it my parents find that it was not very elegant or not proper. And it was for like little kind of person, you know. So it was not so nice. It was not so clean. No. So me, I fantasy about it. So anyway, I saw. So after, I was looking more, maybe people that were wearing that kind of clothes with maybe sometimes a motorbike jacket on the movie of Marlon Brando. So all that was from the street. But I must say like a rebel part because I remember it was a time in the 60s, it was a time when there was les blousons noirs, the black, we call that the blousons noirs. It was some boy from suburb, I suppose that was little gangs, you know, which were supposed not to be bad boy. Maybe like I was a very polite boy, I was maybe a little fascinated by bad one. So it came into my term of like fascination and after movie with like James Dean, most of all Marlon Brando, all that which were rebellious clothes, I find that very attractive and very interesting. Because of course I should say that I love also like in the cinema, like a lot of other things. In cinema was also like showing also that kind of rebellion of the street. So for me, maybe it became like those things are in cinema, so they are not that bad. And they are already recognized, even if they show some kind of people that I am not at all part. But I use it maybe after like a vocabulary, and it inspired me to show it that. And I love to make to see which frontier, you know, because in reality, the code of what is decent, indecent, what is elegant, not elegant, what is luxurious and not luxurious, are very changing through the time.
Well, let's talk now about one of the frontiers that you broke down. You were one of the first to do. You went into the streets of Paris, but not to the streets that we know that are in front of the Grand Palais, but the streets in Barbès, where there's a very mixed community, and in those days, even more so. And that inspired you to do collections. And this was, in a way, breaking a Parisian code, wasn't it? Instead of pretending that these immigrants weren't there, you actually were inspired by their colors, their hair, their clothes, their patterns, and you turned them into your collections.
Definitely. I think I was very inspired by what was different, the people that were different always. Maybe belongs like is more like psychoanalytic, but because me, I felt a little different by the fact that I was rejected being like a child, you know, a little at school, for example, not doing gymnastic well and not playing football. So maybe I was more touched by people that were like a little different and that I felt it could be rejected. So, but they inspired me also because I didn't know it was another world, you know. So I must say that for inspiration, for example, because clothes very clearly, early became my attraction and let's say my obsession. I love, first of all, I was more attracted like to dress the people than to dress myself, you know, because I was not my object of desire, my own person. So I think that if I looked, cinema could inspire me. People different in the street were inspiring me, not what was fashion. Because maybe I was finding what was doing some couturier at the time that I find very inspiring, Saint Laurent, Pierre Cardin, André Courrèges. I like the ones that were different and which I style. I mean their own style. I like the ones that, so they were different. So they have style, so I love them, you know. So everyone that was quite with difference, I love it. But I was not inspired by the jet set. Because at that time in the 60s, you know, was a photo I was from them, they were like very banal, you know, they were like not like dressing that well. And I find that they were, for example, when I started to work, like some people that were not at all in a couture dress, that were some young girl that were, and among the young, I find like more creativity and more interest in fashion in Paris, I speak. Yeah? than in, for example, than in London. In London, it's a little different because people have fun, and the sense of humor makes them like to play more with the clothes and with everything. So in Paris, it was this code: what is chic, what is not chic, and what they find. I remember at Jean Patou, when I worked at Jean Patou, the house of Jean Patou. One time, I was arriving, in the studio working, and I was with like boots, like it was like for doing riding boots, you know. And the vendeuse, the big vendeuse of couture, look at me and say, "Why, your horse is there, you know, but as a reproach, you know," which I find very funny. And but I say, and they were speaking only that beige plus God was beautiful, which can be true, but can be awful too, you know. So there is not like, it's not because that will be beige that it will be the absolute beauty. No, it depends how it's done, how it's made, how it looks like, etc. So I was like, those codes were very like, killing the French fashion, and I should say France in general, because we are so like, it's so absolute, like it has to be like that, you know. Things that I didn't feel, I must say, in London. I think that each time I was going to it, I felt really in love with London because I felt like more freedom, and it was giving me, when I was going there, you know, it gave me like the courage, it sounds a little heavy, but something like, yes, go on to do the thing you feel are good and don't listen to, because it's very conservative in Paris.
If only you'd come to San Francisco, I dread to think what you'd have produced.
That's true.
So here we are. Here is this good little boy who's behaving perfectly and is very charming and wonderful and working hard. How did you turn into an enfant terrible, a bad boy? And tell us about the whole business of putting sexuality on the map, as it were. Mm. You know, that when you go into the exhibition here, it is still faintly shocking to see some of the clothes which are really suggesting a kind of perversity. Mm-hmm. Never, I have to say, against women, which is pretty rare. Mm. But even so, there are clothes there that they certainly, you see a lot of flesh, you see tattoos moved into clothing, all sorts of things that must have been completely taboo when you started doing them in the 70s and the early 80s.
I think it was, yes, and it was. But to be honest, all the things I did that were supposed to be provocative and maybe that make me called through, I think, more the French, the enfant terrible, because maybe some of the people, journalists, didn't saw that I was making jokes only or things like that or provocative thing. It was not as a provocation. I didn't do like my goal is to be known, so I have to make something scandalous. No, it was more because of my reflection and also what I was seeing around me. I mean, like, people were thinking that I was going out a lot and going on all the party. And no, I was working a lot. But I have eyes, and my passion is to see. I am a voyeur, complete voyeur. I love to see, I take image, and you know, I was like educated, I tell you, like through TV, so a lot of movie and a lot of image make me react, and maybe make me understand also sometimes. Sometimes in a wrong way, sometimes because through image you can have an appearance. So I like the trompe-l'œil also sometimes, you know. Sometimes it's true that you have not to consider that all you see in the image is real. That is beautiful because that also can help you to be more creative. So what was going around? It was the after post-rebellion of the women's lib, let's say. And there was some kind of girl in a group in Paris, which the one at the head of that was Edwige, the queen of the punk. And there was in that group like Farida and Frédéric Lorca, that make me meet Farida. And they were like beautiful girls and dressing up. They loved to dress, and they were like quite a very chic and very. At that time, they were, for example, Edwige was wearing like all the Chanel that you find in flea market, because we were a lot going to flea market, and Chanel jacket over a bra, you know, for party and the palace. And me, I was feeling all that, my corsetry of my grandmother, and I see them like in a way that it was not, of course, Saint Laurent did already, like before, like see-through transparency under a smoking, which is a little already, that was like provocative in a way, but it was going well with the time, which was like the moment of sexual liberty and like freedom, also because of the hippies of San Francisco, which also have a message of like freedom, you know. So I should say that after that, it was another way of that the girl wanted to be, like I said, like Madonna, come on, to be strong. They could be strong, could be as strong as a man, but also with like showing a little of their apparent sexuality. But it didn't mean something. It didn't mean that those girls were like very, comment dit-on ça, facile.
Yes.
They were not, it didn't mean that, you know.
Easy, I think, would be
exactly.
A
that's
way of
a perfect
it.
Translation. So that easiness, even like at the time of the, come on, in the 60s with André Courrèges, when he did and Marie Kwan, sorry, because who was the first one to do the mini? He make mini dress on Marie Kwan's mini skirt, no? That's it. So, but they were in short way. That provocative, enfin, that was provocative
but
for some.
This provocation isn't just about the girls, about women feeling their sexuality. It's also about men. I mean, I think
yeah.
I saw, I've seen all your shows, and I think I saw all Yves Saint Laurent's shows, but I don't remember in the Yves Saint Laurent men's collection a male model walking down the runway powdering his nose.
Yeah, definitely, yes. It's maybe me, but maybe because, come on, it's true that because Yves Saint Laurent did things that were already very much about the time, and I saw, and I was very admiring him, he influenced me, that's sure. He did like big steps, you know, on the vocabulary, so I have an enormous admiration about him, because he was also speaking society, which was what was going on in society. So, on me, through my grandmother, I was like feeling that through clothes you can say something, definitely. So, yes, why did I do the men like that, you know? Because I was for equality of sex, in reality, because I saw that what was showing, it was the men's phallocrat world, you know, where the women were, which in reality were strong, they have to be equal of the men, you know, and I wanted to show it. There was some injustice, like, for example, like a blazer, a jacket, double-breasted, you know? You have inside in the men jacket, you have inside a pocket. It's a pocket for the wallet. And the woman, I have never sat, you know. Why? Because it's the man that pay for the restaurant. But they say, but the woman can pay too in the restaurant, no, and invite, you know. So I think there is like a lot of stupid things, not stupid, but revelating of the mentality of one time that has changed and was changing. And the vision of the woman about the men was changing too. Some men were not like accepting. Were accepting their part of femininity. It doesn't mean that they were like gay or whatever. No, it means only that they were accepting that a man can be sensible, and they were. But they have been traumatized by the education that wanted to make them as a John Wayne. You know, apparently, I don't know. Maybe he was very sensitive in reality. To be an actor, you have to be sensitive anyway. But like to look like the real macho, like that. You know. So I wanted to show first collection I did. For me, it was evident it was the male object. Because I always felt like, not insulted, but because I don't consider myself as a woman, but I felt insulted for the woman, like to say, you know, there was that expression, be beautiful and shut up, you know, for the woman, you know, like Brigitte Bardot, it was like that, you know, people were, yeah, okay, so be beautiful and shut up, you have nothing to say. And she had a lot to say, she was a very modern woman, you know, very liberated. And I felt that it was, and why they don't say that to men? Also, there are some that are completely stupid. Maybe some are beautiful, but are beautiful and shut up also, you know. So is what I say, my man, the man that I will show will be a male object. Like that, it's balanced a little. So I don't say that there is only male object. No, not at all. Hélas, maybe. But I wanted to show that there is also a part of femininity in the man, like there is a part, if we can say, of masculinity in the woman.
You mentioned in passing just now Farida Kelfer, who, after all, was the beginning of you showing on the runway models who were not typical of the models of the time. Mm. And I'm sorry to say that it's still true that we see so little diversity on the runways. It's really shameful. And you have always thought that there are different kinds of beauty, certainly different kinds of beauty that come from different countries and origins. Mm-hmm. Will you tell us a little bit about that and how it began for you?
I think it began because also of my childhood, because I remember that I was attracted. I was after when I was like, let's say 11, 12, in a school that was mixed. There were boys and girls. And there was one girl I remember that was coming from, she was a pied-noir. I don't know, you have no expression like that. It means that she was coming from the French colony, you know. She was in Algeria and came back to France. But she was with a very white skin, very, very white, with sparkles. No.
Freckles.
The freckles
is much better.
Glamorous, more glamorous, more glittering. but it's glamorous for me, sparkles. No.
Freckles,
sorry, I cannot say. But she has like beautiful red hair, you know, beautiful red hair, like an Afro type, but red hair. So I was like, oh my God, she's so beautiful and like that. So me, like stupidly, like I say, if I have, that was, yes, it was because for me, like if I want to be friend with someone that I admire, I have to be like him or her. So I couldn't have the red hair. So what I say, I come also from Algeria and I am like you, you know. But I don't know if she believed me, so I was inventing names and like that I heard at the TV, but I don't know if she get it or what, but anyway. So she influenced me. She was very, with a white skin, you could see a vein, you know, through the. So she was very strange but beautiful for me. So that marked me, and always I was attracted by different beauty that I saw everywhere. You know, I remember I saw a movie that was called Guess Who Is Coming to Have Dinner Tonight, you know, with Sidney Poitier, you know. And I remember that I said to my parents, on me, if I arrive, I was 12 also, if I come with a black girl, what will you say? And they say, if you love her, that's perfect for you. And years after, when I told them that I was what they could say about the fact that I was going with a guy, they say, if you love each other, that's wonderful. So I think I was lucky to have parents like that were very modest, but very open-minded. And like for them, there is no question of religion or color of skin or anything like that. People can be all beautiful and nice, depends on how they are, but it's not a question of colors. So for me, all colors were beautiful. And I love to show color, and I love color, color of the skin. A tattoo on the skin, which is a kind of color, some blue that you add, you know, it's a little like the vein of the red hair girl. I wanted to show that. So me, when I started, I remember that the model were like nice, beautiful. There were some beautiful girls, but they were all like the Swedish type, which means like very blonde hair and beautiful, you know, but all the same. And I felt like, okay, but there is also beauty. I have a girlfriend which was modeling for me after that I met very early when I started ITs, which was from Antilles, a French colony, and she was beautiful and black and very inspiring, very nice. And I say, yes, why not? To show more? There was already Saint Laurent was taking some black girls, you know. But for me, difference was beautiful. So I looked at difference and I wanted to show it. And I was also another kind of difference was the fact that I remarked those group of girls, like Farida Kelfer. When I saw Farida Kelfer, I say, my God, she's like incredible. I was very impressed by her beauty. I was very like frightened even by her beauty, you know, because she was like a kind of very arrogant, very imperial, you know, and African beauty with a very special nose on the expression of her lips, like a little, like, a, how do you say that? Not arrogant, like, you know, like, but beautiful. So I say I want to show those girls which are different, doesn't know how to walk as a model, which is better because they have their own personality. And even I remember that those years, I was asking to the professional model to work, to see if they were working too much as a professional model, because I didn't want. I wanted to tell them, please walk like you do in the street. But they were not able, some, because they were like, comment dit-on, like a robot doing their profession, because they were so much, they have no control about they were working. They learned to do that. So is that the conditionment that I didn't like in reality? And I wanted to show people that have only like by their attitude, they were of arriving, some presence that for me was important. I must say that in some way I was a very shy person, but in that I was like confident in my choice about the girl. And I love to do it. And I love to make the casting. For me, it's something, to be honest, I have, it's a reason, because myself I'm very specific, because for me, when I have a boy or a girl which I have to make the fitting, sometimes it's inspiring me so much, you know, everything becomes easy to mix the color because of the color of the hair, the color of the skin. Everything, it's fabulous for me, because I can work and go on it in the joy, and it's a pleasure, you know. Sometimes some that are beautiful, I must say, but I don't know why. Maybe I don't know. Maybe the attitude also, the way to stand, to feel the clothes, it stopped me, and I say I don't know. I don't know what to do. I don't know. And after I realized, maybe I have some difficulty to work with her. It doesn't mean she's not beautiful. She is not nice. It means only that. Sometimes it make me, some make me dream. So, make me dream,
inspire, an inspiration.
Yeah, let's say.
One thing that's very interesting in this exhibition is that you've got this section called Urban Jungle. And at first glance, as you just look through the door and see it, it looks as though it's what you would typically say was taking animals and jungle and things from, I suppose, from Africa or perhaps India, with a lot of animals in it. And as you get closer to the pieces, you realise that these are actually couture pieces, that it's as though you've tamed the jungle. You've gone in there and you've taken, there's one particular, there is the extraordinary leopard dress that has, and as it's very cleverly done, this exhibition, because it actually tells you with the couture pieces how many hours of workmanship were in there. Mm-hmm. So I guess when you pay the bill, you sort of feel it's justified.
That's bizarre, yeah.
But this particular one, I think, I tried to memorize it, I think it's 1,032 hours of handwork and the beading. There are very few designers that I can think of in haute couture who would do something like that. You know, what we've been used to seeing couture very much what I would call salon clothing. In other words, very beautiful and maybe very delicate, but not with this intense animal, vegetable, natural feeling brought into couture. Was doing couture for you something that you wanted to make couture different, or did doing couture make you different as a designer?
It's difficult to answer to that question by the fact that maybe me, I didn't go to fashion school. I learned through looking what was about fashion in TV. At that time, it was only couturier. It was only the couturiers that didn't choose the ready-to-wear, because it was, for France, too vulgar. It was like industrial thing, so no, only couture, because it's aristocracy. It was a little the spirit of France until end of 80s, and they didn't show at all the prêt-à-porter of the creator of the designer of the 80s. But anyway, so I was seeing that couture, so it made me dream, you know. I didn't know that there were, after I realized that there was also people that were not from couture, but as good as couturier as Kenzo, for example, beginning of 70s. When I saw it, I said, oh, I love it, it's nice, and it's different, and it's very creative with skirts that are incredible. At the time, he was fabulous, Kenzo. So, but I love couture through the way that I was looking at magazine. I must say that my teacher was a journalist that were criticizing or saying, explaining the clothes. And sometimes also, we call them stylist, you know, which in reality was the editor, and especially one which is dead now, but she was very inspiring. It was one of the magazine Elle, Nicole Crassa, which was a fabulous, fabulous, fabulous editor. You know, she was mixing the clothes, so she was showing something else than the panoply. Like you have that is matching, like in couture. You know, she was taking an overall, you know, and like putting with high heel and with like jewelry, like very rich jewelry, you know, and it was looking glamorous, you know. So I love the décalage she was doing. So I was inspired also by her because it shows me that you are not obliged, like, to have always like the matching thing. So, but couture, I saw so marvelous things, you know, and it was making me dream, you know, that instead in myself, you know, I am sure that I was like supposed to do couture. But at that time, all the house have their own designer, and there was no place. So when I started as prêt-à-porter, because as a designer of prêt-à-porter, because also I have no money to open a house of couture, no money at all. So it was more like my family or my mother or the concierge that was like sewing, and my cousin like knitting. It was more that kind of thing, you know, a little tribu, but very small, you know. So I should say that, but my base was couture. After I did, and in reality, I must say that I did my ready-to-wear, my first years as couture, without knowing, you know, realizing it, you know. And I think that, honestly, most of the designer of the, of the 80s, like Thierry Mugler, Claude Montana, Marie Beretta, Asdin Alaya also, is completely doing couture, you know. It's real couture. Only the fact that most of the clothes are manufactured after, but in little series some of the time. Some even were not manufactured. You know, it was like a piece. You know, some were piece, let's say, of art. I don't like that expression. Sorry, forget it. I didn't say it. So, but some were truly like making beautiful things. So I went there, and one time it arrives that Francis Menuge, my partner and boyfriend at the time, told me, maybe it should be good if you are doing couture collection. I say, why? And like that, why? Because we don't need now the couturier apart Saint Laurent, you know, they don't do la creation, the creativity. Now it's in the prêt-à-porter, in the designer of the prêt-à-porter in the 80s, you know, of the 80s. And he say, yes, but maybe it's good for perfume, for things like that, and to have also that international passport, let's say. Bon, okay. But in the deep of myself, I know that I should have loved to make one time one couture collection like that. You know, like, to me, like, because I was working at Cardin, because I was at Jean Patou, you know, all that, like dream of the elegance of Paris, a little retro-minding, let's say. And I remember that I proposed at the house of Jean Patou, because when Christian Lacroix left, it was the last new house of couture, let's say, that arrived when he went away from Jean Patou. I thought like to propose to Mr. Demouy, which was the grand nephew of Jean Patou, which was dead, why don't you take one designer like Vivienne Westwood, Thierry Mugler, Claude Montana, myself, Asdin Alaya, to make one season, one couture collection. It should be good and nice. And
you should call up Ben Arnault immediately and suggest this for Dior, a designer for every season.
Yeah, it's true. Each one make his own collection should not be bad. I think it could be very attractive. It's a good idea.
But you know, something I want to ask you here, as you don't want to talk about art, we won't say your work is art. Let's be really vulgar and talk about money.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it's extraordinary what you have produced in couture. Does that make any money?
To be honest, what we produce in couture doesn't make money, but doesn't lose money,
okay,
which is very
so
good.
It's even, so it's, that is
yes.
good.
And I must say, I'm very proud of that, is the fact that when I started to do couture, so after a lot of stories that maybe I should Dior, I don't do it, I didn't do the collection, and I say, okay, so I will do my own collection. I started and never stopped after, because it sells since the first collection. Nicole Kidman bought one, and one woman bought one Marinière done all in lace cut, you know, which is there in the exhibition, and she bought it for a wedding, you know. So, it starts like, okay, I didn't think to make another one, so I do it one after, and one after, and one after, and I am still doing it now. It's like, it started in 97, so It's more than 10 years, like, yeah.
Well, I asked the question because, you know, it's very interesting when you talk about Thierry Mugler and Claude Montano and others who marked the 1980s and earlier, that, you know, so few are around now, as Dina Lowry is still around in a relatively small way. Now you're in the situation that your company has now been, the majority shareholding is now with Pooch, who do the fragrances and have other fashion houses like Nina Ricci, for example. Is this some sort of a new beginning? Was it important to you to have this? Hermès had the controlling stake beforehand, is that right?
Yeah. Definitely, it was a changement. It was a changement because, you know, when Hermès went to my company, it was a moment where it was necessary that we open more shops, more boutiques. So we went with Hermès, and it became something very funny. It was Mr. Dumas, which was there, a fabulous man. And it went that one moment I did even their collection, which was not scheduled at all. It was not something like about contract or like, it's not because they were in my company, like 45%, that it should, I should do their collection. And I did that because for me it was an adventure. I love that adventure because it was, at the beginning I was supposed to be like the contrary, as an enfant terrible, of the established house, very honor and established house of Hermès. But for me, it was kind of challenge, and I love the idea, and I love to do it, you know, because also my training was, when I was at Cardin, I was doing le style Pierre Cardin, you know, I was doing. So at that time, I didn't have my touch, my Gaultier touch, let's say. So there, when I was with Hermès, it was like to make Jean-Paul Gaultier for Hermès. To make Hermès through the eyes of Jean-Paul Gaultier. So that was the point. So it was a challenge for me, and very interesting, I love that. But after Mr. Dumas died, and it was 7 years already that our collaboration, so I think it was good like to go in another, because my life was not with Hermès. I have also my own company. So we changed and we went with Pooch, which is like with the Spanish roots and the perfume roots that sounds very good to my ears and my eyes. So I feel very good with it, and it's necessary also for another challenge. And it's true that I love that kind of adventure. I am quite a truthful person, you know. I think like there is different step in my life. It's around like 15 or 20 years each time, you know. So it's one other step.
Is there always going to be a provocative side to Jean-Paul Gaultier? I mean, thinking of the collection that you did when you were inspired by rabbis, I mean, you've told me that so innocently that you were, I believe you were in New York and you saw a whole bunch of rabbis walking down by the New York Public Library, so you turned it into the collection. But you must have known when you did that, that this kind of mix was pretty dramatic and alarming to many people.
I should say that in some way, I think that I have a kind of, let's say, innocence in myself, like that is the enfant, not terrible part of me, you know, which in the way that when I believe, when I think it's, when it's beautiful, I believe in it. So I saw it was beautiful, I wanted to show it, because and for me it was so strong, the impression when I saw them, it was aesthetically beautiful and with a lot of meaning for me. It was meaning like, for example, people that are like, let's say, a minority, can, when they are all together, as they are strong, as impact, at the same time visually and spiritually. So I wanted to show that beauty that I felt. So after my goal was to show the beauty that I felt, and I should say, make a parallel by the fact that what I felt when I saw them is that, for example, Jewish have been like rejected, like I have been rejected, me from other reasons. When you have all them, so there is some people that to be integrated, they change themselves, they hide themselves. And I think that me, I was lucky because I have not to hide myself, like the fact that my sensibility was different and my sexuality was different. I was lucky of that, you know. So I could express because I went into fashion, and in fashion there is a lot of gay and etc. So I didn't suffer of that. But some suffer of it. So I think that every minority which suffers, there is in those that they are ashamed and they don't say they are. And I felt that it's good, like when you shouldn't have to be ashamed and to hide yourself, you know. And I think it needs courage, I am sure, for a lot of people, you know. But you have to show and to be proud of what you are. So in that collection, the rabbin, it was that also, because they have been rejected, and some maybe they hide, they don't say, and because it's like some taboo about like religion, and you know, it's that. So it's like, if you are all together and showing who you are, you will be accepted, and people will find everything normal. I remember one movie which was very beautiful, is Pain et Chocolat. It's an Italian movie, very beautiful, from the 70s, which show one guy which is Italian, and he goes to work in Switzerland. And he's not integrated at all, you know. And what does he do? He bleaches his hair in blonde, to be integrated, to look like if he was from Switzerland, you know. And one time there is a football game, you know, and he's there in a coffee shop, and he's there looking with all the other men. And one moment, it's Italy against Switzerland. And one time, the Italian win, you know, and he make like, wow, like that, you know. And there, everybody look at him like discovering that he must be Italian, you know. And there, I find that beautiful, at the same time, very emotional and beautiful. And him, he betrayed himself through that reaction. And I think at the same time, it was beautiful, but at the same time, I say, why? It says that you have to change your color hair, even if I did. It was not too far hiding. Or maybe, no, it was like to capture more the light when I did it. that you have to do something like that to deny even your origin. You have to be proud of your origin and to show it.
You're giving me a challenge, or yourself a challenge here, because how is your interest in punk? Think of the punk hair. That's not exactly something to hide behind, is it? It's so out there. And yet, you know, punk has been quite an important part of your collections. Why?
I should say because I have been very marked by that movement, let's say, which was rebellious, of course. So it's in that fashion and our profession is not like a artistic creation absolute, you know. It's part of what's happening in society. Of course, punk movement was very important. There's Edwige, the glamorous queen of the punk. I mean, like, already taken by the society in some way, let's say. Not a real punk. But I must say that when I was going to London, I love that. Like, you know, that expression through the air, through the security pins, through everything, all the looks that were absolutely fabulous. I love that. At the same time, I was fascinated. I was not part of that. Honestly, I was not part of that, but as a voyeur that I am, I was like there. I was at the same time scared and fascinated, you know. And I love them, you know. I was interested in the music and etc. And I love the work of Vivienne Westwood and husband. Ex-husband, the one, Malcolm McLaren. And so I love their work because they did something, but they took also something that was happening a rebellion time. And I love England and London especially for that mix of like so conservative with a bowler hat still, and with having a son which is punk. I love that. So it's influenced me. For example, in London, I saw like some little boys that were in a black trench coat, you know. And in France, you say, no, black is not for children. Black is not, black is bad, black is, all that kind of theory, which is ridiculous. So I felt more confident with them and more close to them. I must say that London, for me, was vitamins that I was taking because I felt like more at home there. Yes, I loved it.
But you know, London has changed, as every city has changed. Yeah. And you certainly won't get any of those hated bankers wearing bowler hats with umbrellas. They'd be frightened of getting lynched by the public. But more to the point, you know, London now is tremendously diverse. Paris is becoming, is showing, admitting that it's more a diverse city. And I'm very struck in the exhibition. There's a little line from you there, quite hidden away, that says, I'm very much a Parisian, or I'm interested in Parisian women, but I'm not quite sure that I've ever really met a Parisian woman. What do you mean by that?
What I mean is like I am, is that my education, I've been like looking through couture, movies, old movies, which I love, from French movies, which speaks about a Parisian on the reputation of the Parisian, which was supposed to dress very well. I regret there is some, but very few. I think that, you know, in France, the eccentricity, maybe for me, because for me, eccentricity is very chic and is what I love. So the eccentricity, it's too much about the bon ton and the good taste, you know, which paralyzes, which makes that it's dying of that, you know. So it's still the city where everybody meets for fashion show. But it's sad, but you don't see only maybe in the young people, but you don't see after when people are on the rail, let's say, in the society, like working on, like having so fun and so joy to dress. You know, it's like you have not to be too much remarkable. You know, you have to be a little like the color of the street of Paris. You have to be a passe-muraille, you know. You have to see through. You have not to be remarked. It's very much in the minding of the people. So I felt a little like it's like, no, we have to be like everyone else. In London, it was completely different. It was. And it's still. There is still like more kind of distance and humor that makes that, for me, they are more fascinating than French, maybe more exotic also.
We're coming to the end because we want to take questions from the audience. But I did just want to ask you a quick question about your work in movies, because that has been so extraordinary and exceptional. And I think probably a lot of people, even, you know, I know you've been to the Academy of Arts with all the students today, but I really wonder how many people in this audience really know how involved you have been in the performing arts, doing costumes. Tell us, is it with Pedro Almodóvar? With whom has it been that you felt the most extraordinary experience?
Ah, alors, I should say, the different experiences are, by order, I think maybe first Pedro Almodóvar, and very close after, I went with Peter Greenaway, which is an English like architect at the base, which is very talented, Luc Besson for The Fifth Element, and also by Caro and Genet for The City of the Lost Children, the one that did Amélie Poulain, you know, and Almodóvar three times, you know. I must say one thing is that I was very lucky because all those people I admire there for their own world, you know, their own one very specific style, which is great, you know. So they were different. For me, it was a fabulous experience because to work with them was to was to get into their story and to see a little of how they are working and how definite they are. I would tell you, for example, one that it's Besson, Luc Besson. In the real life, let's say, not in the movie life, it's somebody that maybe he doesn't dress that well. He has not so much sense of fashion. He has he's not interested too much into that. But when it becomes to the movie, first he will explain you your movie. It's fabulous because he convinces you by telling you the story of his movie. He's so much into it, and visually so much into it. You know, he gets like very. Very upset and about his personage, and he can already imagine how he should like it to be. So to collaborate with them is very beautiful because you can see how much intense it can be and how the movie becomes their world, you know. Same with Almodovar, which is very specific. And sometimes, okay, he needs maybe me a little for some of the clothes, but some he doesn't need me because he knows so specifically. I want, for example, the apron of the maid from Valencia from the 60s. The apron from Valencia from the 60s, okay. So I have to go to the flea market and maybe I will find one with the help because I don't know exactly how is the apron of the maid of Valencia in the 60s. But I mean also the kitschy one, the one of the, not a maid, no, housewife, sorry, not a maid. So it's more abstract, let's say. So, but he's very specific in the color and the things that he wants. But he's absolutely inspiring and fabulous to go into the story. Greenaway, him, it was very different. I saw him only 2 times.
What was the movie?
It was The Cook, The Thief, that one, which was with Helen Mirren, which was absolutely gorgeous and fabulous, and great, fabulous actress. And I saw him, and he told me, show me some painting of Rembrandt, like that in a book, and saying, you see that? Could you do that in modern, in today? I say, I will try. but that's part of the job. That's fabulous. No, it's great. So, okay, so I tried. But after I have, it was one artistic director, which was Dutch, that was working with him, and I get to work with him, and he was very, all the color of the set, he was very specific and fabulous man, truly. For Besson, I told you, person, you know, as also Genet and Caro, were very specific about the color. Very, very, very. And in reality, why they ask me is because they find my color also, were also a little like in their spirit. We went from, I don't know if it is same generation or what, but it's something in common. We had something in common. I was flattered to do that. But it's beautiful to see how much they are, like how works its demand to make a beautiful movie. How works and I shouldn't be able to do one movie. Truly, that I realized easily. I never thought about it, but when people ask me sometime after, I say, no, it's impossible. It's so much, you have to be so much clever.
Well, Tom Ford made a movie.
Fabulous.
Fabulous. Why not you?
But no, because I am not. My brain is not that sharp and not that clever. You know, I am like very mono one thing at one time. So there, it's so many things already for fashion. You have so to think about so many things. But truly, it's a big work, and so nervously, you have to be strong. You know what I mean? Because you have to take care also of the psychology of the actor, which is like, oh my God, you can be depressed. You get all, I will feel all the depression of everybody. So I don't want, it's enough of my own.
Well, Jean-Paul, I hope your brain is sharp enough to answer some of the questions that have been put through here. Because rather like the Academy Awards, you know. So these questions have come through and on various means. And so can we have the first question?
Well, the first question is actually, I'm going to compile a group. It's a lot of people are asking, what's currently inspiring you from different cultures, the internet, textile design? What exciting things are you seeing in contemporary textile design? And so just what are you reading?
And what I am?
Reading.
Definitely, that's very sad, but I read. I have not enough time to read. That's a very sad part. So I am not enough reading, but I start. Getting older, now I get closer. Now that nobody is no more reading, I will read. No, it's my kind of rebellion. I think, honestly, that is a question of time, but reading bring inspiration. But that's the problem. Because I get into a book and I say, oh my God, I can make one collection there. Schlack. After like 3 lines. So sometimes if the book is good. So no, it's a joke. but it can be. Of course, you know what? I read, like, for example, one time I did like the existentialist collection years ago. And there, I was thinking the existentialist because I saw Juliette Gréco and I heard about, of course, Jean-Paul Sartre, etc. So I read after the book, like to know more, you know, to get into it. You know, it's like in some way, like to do a movie, like to feel and to know what's happened. And sometimes, like the explanation can give you, for example, the Dadaist. Dadaist. I read about Dadaist and I learned and I understood. But so after, I didn't do like a collection literally like patch of Dadaist. No, I did it with décolleté, things like that, my interpretation. Because I try to understand the base, I mean like the concept, more than the effect. So it's good. So you have to read, definitely.
Creativity is so difficult to define by creative people because you just do it instinctively. Yeah. You were telling me that last night something inspired you and you went back and you drew for your next collection until 4 a.m. What inspired you? Do you know what set it off?
I think it's a succession of images sometimes. Some or ones that you don't expect at all. All the surprise can be all the surprise. It was not the case yesterday. It was yesterday. During the night. It was more like image that I have seen. I received little by little, and I didn't know how to treat it. And I suppose I saw some things that making me think about it yesterday night. And after it came, and I wake up, and instantly it came like, oh yes, I could use it like that, and do it also in fur, and da 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 da. So I wrote that not to remember, and after I was into it, and like trying to. So it's very exciting. I should say it's the best moment when you do that because it's like yes, I find it because always you are looking for something you don't know what in reality. So sometimes it becomes more concrete, and it gives you. I need to have that, let's say, colon vertebral, you know, that makes you that after you have that direction and you go on and work on it. It's a real pleasure. It's like to try to interpret in the best way from that idea. So it can be ethnic. It can be sometimes ethnic. Sometimes also like overseen some things in fashion that you say, oh, reaction against that. Can be that too. Can be somebody walking, moving, putting her hand in a way where there is no pocket, but it should have been a pocket, so that that you see the desire or what should be good for it. You know, it's looking at, to eat food. Food is visual for me.
Can you, out of all that, just think of one single example of something that you saw, I don't know, a green leaf or something on the internet or something in a movie, something that directly inspired you so that you were almost drawing a minute later from it?
I think it was years ago when I did my Cyrillic constructivist collection. I saw a book. It's one of my assistants. She was like a graphic assistant and she had a book with her. So already she did like a choice incredible because I was there and I was like loving everything. But you know, it's like a physical reaction. It's like if I want to eat it, you know, it's like, because maybe it makes me think about food. I don't know. It was coffee plus vanilla plus I don't know what. But it was truly like beautiful colors and all the constructivist that I didn't know. You know, I know some things like that that I didn't even know. It was constructivist, you know. And I saw it so beautiful. The book was so perfect that I wanted to have it all. So I make photocopy of all the and photos of all the book, and I wanted to have all around me, like to get into it and to see through that, you know. So it was. So that is one thing. Another thing.
No, one is enough.
One is enough. Well, but to be honest, internet no. You know what? Because there is too much selection. I like the part of emotion, which I mean like surprise. I go somewhere, and I find that I didn't expect. It's there that I have the real shock. I mean, like I say, oh, I have my reaction. You know. Mm-hmm. So sometimes it doesn't happen. Sometimes it's happened late. Sometimes it doesn't happen. But so what I do in that case, I will not tell you.
Well, that might lead to the next question. What scares you?
What scares you?
Frightens you?
What scares me? Maybe not to be more in love with my work.
Yeah.
I suppose. Yeah. Because it's a passion. Yeah. So for the moment, the passion doesn't stop.
So you mean you're scared that there might be one day, I'm sure it will never happen, when you don't have that energy anymore. That's yes.
Well,
you're not scared of a piece of blank paper and the collection coming up in 6 weeks and, oh, my God, what am I going to do? That doesn't scare you?
Yes, but I try to protect myself. Like, for example, you know, I go to flea market, I go to antique place, I go to when I see something that you know I find interesting, even if I have no, it doesn't serve to anything for the moment. I say one day I will do something from that because I know that there is something to work on it, you know. So maybe it's not for them. So I have a lot now. I have too much. I think I have to burn it because at the end I take too much time to look at it. So, but it's good. But yes, no. I mean, like to be honest, I think the time I will realize that maybe I have no more the passion, and so it will mean I will stop. I think it's better because why to lie? You know, it's like I've been honest. You know, honestly, since the time before I was doing that profession, I was lying because I was not maybe happy the fact that I was rejected. So I was saying big lies. I was inventing that I was from Algeria. I was inventing a lot of things. You know, at the moment I started to work at Pierre Cardin, I said finish. I cannot lie anymore because I have to say the truth. Because I don't. Why? Because I do the things that I love to do, and why should I lie now? There is no reason to lie, you know, because I am accepted through my work. So why should I lie? So I don't want to lie again in my old days, you know. So if I am not in love anymore, voila, that's it, and it's very nice. But I will be always interested in fashion.
And the next question is for both of you. What do you think it's, how is it in the fashion world for larger size women?
Sorry, how it's?
How is it, how is it in the fashion world for larger size women?
Well, I'm going to answer this first, since I was so happy when Beth Ditto appeared in one of Jean-Paul's collections, because I don't know if you all know Beth Ditto, but she's a terrific woman, and she is quite rotund in size. Mm-hmm. And I haven't quite caught up with her yet, but I certainly am no thick little stick. And I personally think that one of the things that Jean-Paul should be admired for is not to bring the tyranny of fashion to women. He has, as he's explained, done a lot for diversity in terms of diversity of type, skin type, but also diversity of style and shape. And I think that that was a reason for a round of applause for Jean-Paul.
But there is one diversity also which is important, is age. And that I should explain only it because, you know, in fashion it's very terrible because there is always like the racism about age, you know, like there is, one of the racism there is in fashion, which I absolutely against. But how could I be against age when I have a grandmother that let me do everything I wanted and like give me optimism, positivity? So it's beautiful. I think like people that are old have experience and you can learn a lot from them, and they are maybe sometimes more sweet than the grandparents are more sweeter than the parents. No, I was there. But they let you do everything you want. So that's great. So no, I think it's age also is something important that we have to see. You know, because I remember I wanted to do one time one collection only with old person, you know. And there is some journalist that told me, don't do that because we don't like to see ourselves like projecting as old. And I didn't do it. I put some time, you know, I didn't listen. But for the moment, I didn't yet because I knew I have to do a casting, special but very specific, which what I want to show through that, the beauty through the edge, which there is, you know. But so I will do it one time. Maybe it will be my last collection, that one. I will be part of the show and I will walk.
And your final question, and it comes from a Twitter question. What advice do you have for young artists and designers to be successful in a world with so much competition and talent?
It's difficult to give advice because did I add advice when I started? I don't know. I have only my passion. So what I can say is that it's like if truly they love fashion, if they want to do their profession with fashion, if they see only that, at that point they do on whatever they will do. They will find solution. Because the thing in fashion is like to be right up with the moment, with the society, with the desire, with what people need, and to understand also how are going, also economically, because of course now we are in a moment where economically and with the crisis, there is a lot of things, and things cannot go. Now there is sure a lot of people, a lot of competition. There is even like sometimes like more clothes than people to wear it, you know. So it's reality. So knowing all that, you have to take decision, and you have to, you have to have like a vision about it, and to find solution about it, and to propose the right thing. So the ones that think I want to do it, and to do the right thing for now, they will do it. So only courage and love what you do, and it's a marvelous work. I must say that me, I am lucky because I did that work that I loved, and doing it, I love it even more. You know, it permit me like to be accepted and loved. Mm-hmm. So if you receive love, you can give love.
Yay.
We can't really have a more beautiful ending than that, but I'm going to use my chance to just to ask one last question. Jean-Paul Gaultier, do you believe that you have marked fashion history?
It's difficult to say. Is it my purpose to mark? Is it my purpose? I don't know. I think that everybody is marking fashion history in a way, you know. I mean, as much as journalists, because they show to people. What is fashion history? It's part of still here, alors some old clothes, some that you can find maybe in the flea market, antique shop, in the museum, books, magazine, newspaper. I think that I am part of that. But to think that me, I marked, I don't think so. And it's not exactly my purpose. In reality, it's very selfish to do what you love, you know, the most important thing.
Well, I'm glad I managed more or less to silence you with my question. And I would like to say that I believe you have marked fashion history in the best way by creating clothes which have been a mirror to society as it changed and as it happened, and that you will be known for that as much as for the beauty of the clothes. And thank you so much for giving the chance to talk to you. Thank you.